What do you think of this idea for our food supply? How about we develop a pesticide that we can spray on plants that forms really sharp, hard crystals that will then damage the mouth parts of the insects who try to eat the plants. So they chew away at the leaves and then their mouths fall to bits and they leave, or they can't eat it anymore. Isn't that a great idea? Unfortunately, in this scenario, these crystals will then be on the plant and we will eat them when we eat the plant, and they will cause crystal buildup in our kidneys and in our eyes and in our heart tissues and give us some quite significant health problems over a period of time because they'll build up in our bodies causing massive inflammation and arthritis. What do you think of that? Welcome to ShapeFixer. I'm Andrew, I'm a nutritionist, and today I'm going to speak about an aspect of plant pesticides that we don't speak about or think about nearly enough. So let's take a step back here. There is good news and bad news. Okay, so let's just clear the air here. The good news is that was a hypothetical idea. We do not make a pesticide like that. But hang on, it's not all good news. Let's talk about what the plants do. Plants are living organisms, just like us, you and me, and every other creature on this planet. And nature is about an arms race, eat or be eaten. And we all think about the classic lion against the antelope on the African savannah. The lion gets bigger and stronger and has big fangs and learns to hunt in a pride. And the antelope just grow faster at running so they can run away. They grow horns so they can fight back. Animals run away. Animals hide. Animals fight back physically. What do plants do? They can't hide, they can't run away. They can protect themselves to a point. Some of them grow thorns, yeah. Mostly, they resort to chemical warfare. If you get lost in the forest and you don't find your way out and you don't get found by a search party, chances are you are probably going to either starve to death or die of poisoning because you've eaten something you shouldn't eat. There are 400,000 species of plant on our planet that we have identified and classified and named, and a very, very, very small proportion of them are in fact edible. And even that doesn't necessarily mean anything, because does that mean it won't kill you straight away, or does that mean it will have toxins in it that your body can manage, or that your body can only manage for a period and eventually it'll kill you? What does it even mean? Plants produce chemicals to protect themselves. So they will taste bad, so they don't get eaten. Or they will make you sick, so that you don't eat them again. Or, if you're pretty unlucky, they will kill you straight away. They don't care one way or the other, so long as they don't get eaten. So what is all this about pesticides and crystals? A lot of plants produce a group of chemicals referred to as oxalates. Oxalates are classed as an anti-nutrient when we're talking about human nutrition and biology. And oxalates form these crystals, usually with calcium, as soon as they start getting attacked. And yes, they do damage the mouth parts of the insects. But when we eat those plants, we eat the oxalates, we have a buildup of oxalic acid in our blood, which then takes calcium from our blood to build calcium oxalate crystals. Those crystals are toxic. They then need to be put away somewhere in our body. Firstly, they go to the kidney because the kidney will try to flush them out. So if you maintain quite a low level of oxalate intake, your kidneys will be able to keep up and you will keep flushing them out. You may damage your kidneys to some extent in the process, but it's not chronic yet. Above a certain level of oxalate intake, the crystals have to go somewhere. So you start making kidney stones, you get crystal buildup in your joints, typically gout, or what is referred to as pseudo-gout, because it's not uric acid, it is oxalic acid crystals, still gout. arthritis, they build up in your eyes and damage your sight. They can build up in your heart tissues and give you heart problems. This isn't nice. Clearly, we shouldn't be eating this stuff. Now, the bad news is that plants make them to defend themselves. A stinging nettle, if you're familiar with a stinging nettle and how when you brush your skin against the leaves, it burns and produces a big rash, this nettle is injecting calcium oxalate crystals into your skin. This is very much a defense mechanism. Now, the problem with this, one of the problems with this is when the crystals are formed, the oxalate is combining with calcium. Where does it get the calcium from? It pulls the calcium out of your blood. And it's very important to have the right level of calcium in your blood at all times. One of the main functions of calcium in your blood is to regulate your heartbeat. You would die without the proper level of calcium in your blood. So immediately, your body starts to demineralize your bones to release calcium from your bones to bring it into the blood to replace the calcium that the oxalates have taken away. What does that do to your bones? You end up getting weaker bones and you can end up with osteopenia or osteoporosis. So this is bad for your bones. Now, unfortunately, this kind of toxicity builds up and affects you over a long period of time. It can be decades of eating the wrong foods before you start to see the symptoms. That doesn't make it safe or non-toxic just because it doesn't kill you straight away. You can smoke a packet of cigarettes this afternoon and you won't be dead tomorrow morning. It takes time. Cigarettes, alcohol, sugar, same with oxalates. It builds up over time and you have long-term problems, which are very often not diagnosed because it's not something that is front of mind that people think about. So Liam Hemsworth, the actor, Chris Hemsworth's brother, he is a vegan, maybe not now, I don't know. He was a vegan and he ramped up his morning smoothies and then he was rushed to hospital for emergency surgery from acute oxalate poisoning. What is it that contains all these oxalates that we should be cutting? I say cutting out of our diet altogether, but certainly cutting down and managing. If you have the knowledge, you can manage yourself as an responsible adult. My advice would be to just cut them out altogether. The foods that contain the most oxalates, number one on the list with a very, very high oxalate level, is spinach. Chard, rhubarb, almonds, most nuts, and I say most nuts after saying almonds because an almond is not a nut. An almond is the pip of a fruit in the same family as the peach. Legumes, so beans, and potatoes, in particular sweet potatoes. All these things we're told are healthy, wonderful healthy, almost a superfood. Spinach, wow, it's full of iron. Yeah, it's very high in oxalates. And oxalates do not only draw calcium out of your blood, they also interfere with your absorption of iron. So you don't even absorb most of the iron that's in the spinach anyway. Eat some meat. You get your iron from meat. Spinach is poisoning you over a long period of time because it's building up oxalates in your body, calcium oxalate crystals, which eventually are going to cause you to have all sorts of metabolic problems, which are then not easy to fix. You can't just stop eating it and expect everything to be fine by tomorrow. It takes a long time to work those crystals out of your body and you can have an unpleasant experience along the way. Because once you stop eating oxalates, your body says, thank goodness, now it's time to go and unpack all the oxalates that we have stuffed away in the joints, in the kidneys, in the heart, in between the muscles, in the eyes, and pull them all back out into the blood and process them through the kidney. So you could actually develop kidney stones after you've stopped taking oxalates because your body needs to clear them out. And that process can take months. So the sooner you stop eating them, the better. A misunderstanding about kidney stones is the idea that a lot of people still believe that kidney stones are caused by having too much calcium. That's nonsense. It's calcium oxalate, and it's the oxalate that pulls the calcium out of your blood and forms the crystals. It's not too much calcium. It's too much oxalate. Please have a look at what you eat and see if there's something obvious. I know I was doing it. I was eating 200 grams of cashews every single day. That is about 200 milligrams of oxalates, and you shouldn't eat more than about 20 milligrams of oxalates a day. And I had oxalate crystal buildup in my hip tendons, and I actually had these crystals removed surgically about 20 years ago, but I didn't realize it was an oxalate thing. I was told it was calcium crystals. What is a calcium crystal? Calcium doesn't even make crystals by itself. And more recently, around the time I had hip arthritis, I had crystal buildup in my other hip. But I was able to resolve that by changing my diet and being patient and working it all out of my system. So please share this with anybody who has kidney stones, who has sort of mystery tendon pains that aren't being clearly diagnosed, and have a look at their diet and see if there's a link to any of these high oxalate foods and their symptoms. So thank you again for your time, for subscribing to our channel, and for liking this video.